In this lesson and the next, we're going to be talking about correlation and linear regression. Well, when we're working with correlation and regression analysis, what we're essentially trying to find out is that if one variable affects another. For instance, let's assume that I think as an instructor that there might be a relationship between the number of classes a student attends in statistics and their final score on the final. So, correlation and regression analysis actually lets me prove or disprove my hypothesis. When we're doing correlation and regression analysis, we're going to have two kinds of variables. We're going to have a dependent variable, and we're also going to have independent variables, or an independent variable, depending on whether we have one or multiple. The dependent variable is what we're trying to predict, what our hypothesis is based on. And so with my example before, if I'm predicting the student's final grade based on the number of classes that they've attended, well, the dependent variable would be the student's final grade. It is dependent upon, or at least I think it's dependent upon, the number of classes attended. And so with the other examples we see here, the final statistics grade would be the dependent variable, and we're assuming, or we're trying to predict, if it is dependent upon the amount of time the students spend studying. And with the other example we see on this slide here, the miles per gallon is what we're trying to predict, and we're trying to see if it's related to, or if there's a correlation between the miles per gallon and the independent variable, which in this case would be the weight of the car. One method that we can use to see if there's a correlation between an independent and a dependent variable is a scatter diagram. Now, we've already explored the concept of a scatter diagram here, but with the example that we see here, we have some copiers who are making some sales calls, and then the number of copiers that they've sold. And so we've plotted each of those. And you can kind of see by looking at that scatter diagram that the more sales calls we make, and it looks like that the more copiers we're going to sell. So it would appear, at least according to this visual diagram, that there is a correlation or a relationship between those two. Using a scatter diagram is great, and we can visually see that there probably is indeed a relationship, a correlation between the number of copiers sold and the number of sales calls made with that previous example here. But what we'd really like here is we'd like some statistical evidence. We'd like to know how strong the correlation is, and if we are actually able to predict the number of copiers that we're going to sell based on the number of sales calls that we make. And so that's where we're going to go into next. We're going to be working with a correlation coefficient and also developing a regression equation. Well, we're actually going to be computing something called the coefficient of correlation, and that is represented with the R. And that is a measure of how strong the two variables are related. And as you can see here, it can range from negative 1 to positive 1. And if our R was computed to be a positive 1, that means there's a perfect or a 1-to-1 correlation. And so for every sales call that I made, I would sell one copier. If it was a negative 1, it would work just the opposite. I would sell one fewer copier for every sales call that I made. And it would be very rare, if not impossible, that you would run into a statistical correlation of an R being 1. And so typically you're going to run into R's being from 0, 0.75, 0.95, and you can see how those are actually measured. So if we have, for instance, a 0.5, that would be a moderate, either positive or negative. If we have something less than 0.5, it's going to be a weak negative or positive. And if we have greater than 0.5, it's going to be a strong negative or positive, depending on which way it is. And so we're going to show you how to compute that R here in just a second so we can actually see how strong the relationship is between the independent and dependent variables. Computing the R, or the correlation coefficient, is really not that difficult. The formula looks complex, and if you're doing it manually, it's really not that bad either. It's really nothing more than we have done in the past. But if you look at the formula is simply the sum of x minus x bar times y minus y bar divided by n minus 1 times the standard deviation of x and the standard deviation of y. And those are very easy to compute. And so using the copier sales example, we can see that we've done the x bar, x minus x bar, y minus y bar, and we've summed them up. And anyway, we would then come up with a correlation coefficient of 0.759. And as this slide tells us here, if we do have a correlation of 0.759, that's very close to 1, so that would be a strong positive correlation between the number of sales calls and the number of copiers that we sell. Now, we're going to show you a little quicker, easier way to do that, to compute the R, and that is use Excel. And the further we get in regression analysis and correlation, we'll see that Excel is an extremely powerful tool, and we do want to use it as much as we can. Well, there's a couple things I want to mention about Excel. First off, there will be an Excel tutorial to show you how to do correlation and regression analysis. But if you notice at the top of the slide in italics here, it says regression data copier sales data file. There is a data file in Blackboard called regression data copier sales that will show you how to compute the R and several of the other things we're going to be doing here manually. It also shows you in this slide that there is an Excel function to do correlation. So all we have to do is just select the two ranges, use the CORREL function, and we'll get the R computed for us very easily. And it gets even easier in Excel, so make sure you do watch the Excel tutorials that are included as part of this lesson. As we're doing correlation and regression analysis, we're going to be testing things at different levels to kind of make sure that what we've got is actually true. So one of the things we're going to be doing is we're going to be testing the significance of the correlation coefficient and seeing if it can indeed be applied to the population. We do that by computing a t statistic based on the R. And so in this case, we would have a hypothesis is that the little p symbol there stands for rho, which is the correlation within the population, because remember, this is just a sample and we're trying to see if it can be applied to the population. So the null hypothesis would be that the correlation of the population is zero. The alternate hypothesis would be that it is not zero. So we're going to go through the five-step hypothesis testing process to test the R that we came up with. And you can see that the formula to compute the T is very simple. We just take the R that we've computed, and we also use the sample size to compute that. We use an N minus 2 degrees of freedom. Of course, in the next slide, we'll look up the critical value and compute it and see if we are going to be able to reject or not reject the null hypothesis. All right, so our level of significance in this case is going to be 0.05, and this is a two-tailed test because it's equal versus not equal. And so we've looked up using the degrees of freedom of n minus 2, and there were a sample size of 10. So with the degrees of freedom of 8, we came up with a critical t that we're comparing our computed t to as 2.306. And you see at the bottom of the slide there is an Excel function that would also compute this for you. So the next step is to actually compute the t with that formula that we had just a second ago and then compare it to the critical value to see if we reject or do not reject the null hypothesis. And remember, the null hypothesis is that the correlation of the population is zero. Okay, so using the formula that we introduced briefly, we end up with a computed t using our R of 0.759 with our sample size of 10 of 3.297. We compare that to the critical t value, and we can see that it is outside the do not reject area, so we're going to reject the null hypothesis, and we're going to conclude in this case that the correlation of the population is not zero. So our R, we're assuming, is fairly accurate. All right, we've determined that there is a relationship, there is a correlation, a strong positive correlation between the number of sales calls an individual makes, a salesperson makes, and the number of copiers that they're going to sell. Well, what we'd like to be able to do now is we'd like to be able to develop an equation that would allow us to predict, okay, if Joe makes 50 sales calls, how many copiers is he going to sell? And that's where we can come up with a regression equation, and that's where we're going to go in the next few slides here. Regression analysis uses something called the least squares principle. The equation that we're going to get is not exactly perfect. It's not going to allow you to, you know, perfectly predict a value of the dependent variable. It's going to vary a little bit, but what the regression equation is going to do is going to minimize the error between the predicted values and the actual values that you get. So it's going to plot a straight line that minimizes the error. What you're looking at here is a linear regression model or regression equation. The y hat is the predicted value of y, y being the dependent variable. With the two examples that we've talked about so far, that would be the number of copiers that were sold or the score on the student's final or the stats class. And y hat, or the predicted value of y, is going to first equal a, which is the intercept. That's the value of y when x equals 0. And x, remember, is the independent variable. So with the example of copiers sold and sales calls, so if we don't make any sales calls at all, how many copiers can we expect to sell? That's going to be the intercept. Then we have the intercept plus the slope, which is how much of an increase in y do we have for each increase in x. And we're going to be computing this. It's very easy to compute. So it's simply the regression formula is the predicted value of y equals the intercept, the value when x is 0, plus whatever the slope of x is, the slope of the line is, times how many of x, or how many of the independent variables there are. All right, you'll notice the first thing we had to compute was r, and r is useful in computing the slope, and of course we need the slope in order to compute the intercept. Here you have the formulas for computing the slope and also the y-intercept, and that's great. It's pretty easy to do that, but there's also very easy functions in Excel. There's a slope and an intercept function in Excel, which we'll talk about, and hopefully you'll use the Copier sales data worksheet in Blackboard. Okay, just another quick plug for using that Copier sales data worksheet that's in the Blackboard. We're going to go ahead and compute a regression equation. We'll show you how to do it through the slideshow here, at least manually, through some manual equations. But if you look at that Copier sales regression data worksheet, there's going to be a solved tab, and that solved tab will actually show you how to compute some of these things using both the longhand method in Excel and also some of the shortcut methods. But anyway, do pull that up after you get done viewing this slideshow. There is going to be an Excel tutorial, and I will go over the Copier sales data a little bit as well. But we're going to go ahead and show you how to compute the regression equation manually in the next few slides. Okay, so here's the example with the Copier sales data. So we'd like to know is, if we are going to make 20 calls, what can we predict, or what can we expect as far as the number of copiers sold? Regression equation, we have to find the slope and the intercept. And you can see that we have found the slope manually using the R, the correlation coefficient, and also the standard deviation of x and the standard deviation of y. And so using the values that we have from the Copier sales data, we end up with a slope of 1.1842. So that tells us that for every sales call, we can expect to sell 1.1842 copiers for every sales call made. Then once we have the slope, we can go ahead and compute the intercept. And using the formula given here, we have an intercept of 18.9476. So now we finally have our regression equation. The regression equation turns out to be the predicted value of y hat, or the number of copiers that we sell, is going to be 18.9476 plus 1.1842 times x. So using the example of how many would we expect to sell if we had 20 sales calls, well, popping the numbers into the formula, we would expect to sell, or the predicted value of y would be 42.6316 copiers. Just as we had to test the correlation coefficient, we also need to test the slope and see if it is statistically relevant. And so in this case, we're going to go through the hypothesis test of the slope. So the null hypothesis would be that the slope is zero, statistically significant as zero. The alternate hypothesis is that it's not equal zero within a certain level of significance. So the alpha we're going to use is 0.05. So we look up the same critical value with the degrees of freedom n minus 2 or 8, and we still end up with a critical t value of 2.306. So now we're actually going to compute a t based on the slope, and we'll show you how to do that in the next slide. If you're using the Copier sales data, or do use it after you're done with the slideshow, you'll have a place where you can compute the t. But using the formula given, it's simply going to be the slope minus 0 divided by the standard error of the slope. And we haven't shown you how to compute the standard error of the slope, but we will here in just a second. But assuming it's already done, we end up with a t for the slope of 3.297. And you can see that is greater than the 2.306, so we would reject the null hypothesis and therefore conclude that there is a statistically significant slope with the regression equation that we computed. When you use Excel's data analysis regression feature, this is the output that you're going to get. Let me just kind of go over this briefly. Notice that we have a multiple R. That is the correlation coefficient, which is the 0.759 that we computed manually a few minutes ago, or we could have also used the correlation function. Excel also creates an ANOVA table. I do want to point out, though, that as the book refers to SST and SSE, with regression analysis, the SST is referred to as regression, the SSE is referred to as residual. Then we finally have the regression equation. You see the word intercept there, and we do see that the intercept coefficient is 18.94, which is what we saw manually when we computed it, so that is the intercept. We also have the x variable 1 coefficient. That coefficient for x variable 1 is the slope. We also have the standard error of the slope. The book will show you how to compute that manually, but Excel will compute that for you if you use regression analysis. We also have the t-stat computed of the slope, the 3.29 that we just discussed just a minute ago. So you can see that there's a lot of very useful information computed for you here automatically when you use Excel's regression analysis feature. When we do regression analysis, we're also concerned about the standard error of the estimate, and that measures the dispersion of the predicted values to the actual values, and we can see that there's a formula to compute this. However, if you're using the Excel regression feature, it will compute this for you, and we'll show you that in the next slide. And you can see in yellow here, it does compute, Excel will compute the standard error for you, and that is the same number that the book comes up with when they're doing it manually. All right, we have another variation of R, and that's called the coefficient of determination. It's represented with R square, and it's the proportion of the total variation of the dependent variable that can be explained by the independent variable. And it can range, just like the R, from 0 to 1. A 100% would say that 100% of the variation of Y could be attributed to variations in X. So with our copier example, we had an R of 0.759. Well, the R square would be 0.756, and so that would tell us that 57.6% of the variation of the number of copiers sold can be explained by the variation in the number of sales calls. And as you probably guessed, I was going to tell you that Excel also computes the R square. You can see that right below the yellow multiple R. We have the R square shown for us when we use the data analysis regression feature, and we see that it is 0.576.